Hi guys, I'm going to be having a session with Habi, and what the session is all about will be how you properly structure your YouTube project when you want to start working on web development using YouTube framework. So I'm going to share meeting link with him. So while I'm waiting for him, the purpose of this session is for us to properly understand the best way to structure our project in terms of the configuration, in terms of the controllers, the views, the model, and sometimes using modules as well. So this session will enlighten us on how to really go about it and build a properly structured, scalable application. Meaning the kind of code you should be writing should be the kind of code that can be passed on to the next developer, and the developer will not have difficulty, you know, taking over the job. Hi Abby, how you doing?
Hey, very well, finally.
Yeah, so how's it going?
I'm fine.
So I want to share my screen with you. Alright?
Oh, okay.
We get started with it.
Okay.
So
let me get my pen and
alright.
Okay, I'm doing
it. Alright. First, I'm sure you can see my screen, right?
Yes, I can.
So I'm gonna just start afresh as if I just downloaded the project folder from Ye official website. So this is the folder. I'm just gonna extract it and get started with it.
Yeah.
All right. So now that we have the folder extracted, so what I'm gonna do is that I'm gonna move it. As a matter of fact, we're going to leave it where it is. And for us, so let me just change it. Let me leave it as basic. And
okay. And
one other thing I need to do is open this project folder in my IDE. So I'll just open and go to folder, desktop, and it's going to be basic. Yes. So I'm using IntelliJ, right? That's the IDE, IntelliJ IDE. And so the next thing I want to do is to make sure that this application is actually accessible on the browser. So in my development, I'm not making use of SAMP or LAMP. Instead, I'm making use of Docker. So basically, Docker is a tool designed to make it easier to create, to deploy, to run applications, you know, when using containers. So, and what container does is container allow a developer to package up an application, you know, with all the parts it needs, such as library and other dependencies, right? So, for instance, let's say I don't have PHP installed. I don't have MySQL installed, as an example, right? And so, for all of those, I do not really need to install SAMP or anything. What Docker does is it has created some sort of a virtual local operating system for me, or environment for me, that I can easily set up all of those guys and run at speed. And the good thing is the fact that Ye2 itself gave us Docker Compose. Docker Compose is like the that means Ye framework itself has already been configured to support Docker. Meaning all you just need to do is make sure your Docker is running and you're good to go. All right.
Okay.
And first, I need to check if my Docker is up.
So one has to install Docker.
Yes. So once you install Docker, right? So once you install Docker, the next thing you just need to do is you need to make sure that your Docker is actually accessible everywhere. But for me, Docker is accessible. So what I just need to do is I need to make sure I make use of a port that I have not used before. So I'm going to make it 8005. I think I've used from 8 from 1 to 4. All right. So the next thing I would need to do is I will hit Docker compose up. Right. Now running Docker compose up, if you do not have PHP installed or you do not have MySQL, whatever dependencies that your application needs, automatically to install it, then run the application. So while I'm doing that, I just go to my browser and access 5 and see if it's working. Voila, it's working.
Wow.
So it's easier for you to really set up your application without trying to install XAMPP or without getting worried about where your project is located. As a matter of fact, you can have your project directory located on a desktop. So because we all know the restriction of making sure your project folder is inside XAMPP or htdocs for, when we are using XAMPP.
Yeah, htdocs, yes.
So this does not restrict
XAMPP,
you.
Yes.
Right? In case you want to write in other programming language as well, the likes of Python, Go, or whatever framework you're using, including Node, right? You don't have to install all those dependency into your local system. Instead, you just install them into Docker, and Docker manages everything for you. So the application is successfully running, and the next thing we need to do is to make sure we are not even seeing the error. And this particular error we see has to do with basic, but if you are making use of advanced templates, what you see will not be what you are looking at right now. So the basic we are looking at is just because of the cookie, and I'm sure you are familiar with that particular.
The
main purpose of this session is not about how to actually write in Yi, but how to properly structure your code. So it's gonna be it's gonna be precise and quick. So we just need to just put jargons there, right? And we're good to go. All right. And so what the next thing I will need to do is that for instance, let's say we are going to URL. Right, so you might not really want to make use of this default URL look. You might want to have a pretty URL enabled, so that you can look at how you are structuring your project folder and versus how it looks on the URL. I'm gonna enable this. So this enables the pretty URL for us, and the next thing I need to do is I need to talk about.
So does that thing work without having your HT access?
Yes, you don't have to bother about HT access anymore.
Yeah, it's in Docker.
Yes, so basically, what Docker does, based on the Docker compose that was given, right? So the way it has been configured is that it will need to access, your actual. It has been configured in a way that it will directly access the default file you're supposed to use and just run it.
Okay.
Right. All you just need to be bothered about is the port number.
Is the port number?
Yes. And so that's it. So the next thing is, let's say we want to create a project. I'm just going to use a typical scenario of a project. And what are the things our project will have? Let me pull up a note. Sticker. Right, let me pull up sticker. All right, so let me just take this. So first we are going to, let's say we want to create a project now, and the kind of project we want to create is just a mini project that will allow us to have a profile, that will allow us to have let's say to-do list, right? And allow us to, you know, let's say share info as an example. So first, if we want to create such project, right, we'll go to controller. And so there are a couple of things I noticed in terms of the controller, right? So there are so many scenarios where maybe you want to build profile, you want to be, and remember profile, if you have to go by the basics of profile, you might want, you might have let's say the regular CRUD actions, CRUD actions in general itself, right? Meaning you might create action, read action, update and delete action.
Yeah, update and delete.
And it will be wrong for you to, it will be wrong, not even wrong per se, because eventually it's going to work, but it will be cumbersome for you to have all of those actions placed in controller. Just imagine you have that action here, right, for, I don't even know how you're going to, I don't even know how it will be done, right? Let's say we have profile create, then in case you want to have another one, then you start doing profile
updates or read,
read or update or something. So it's going to be a lot for all of those actions to be placed in a single controller. So in that case, what you need to do is there will be a need for you to create another controller, and I'll tell you why it is quite important, right? So let's say we are creating a controller called profile controller, right? So what we need to do is we need to extend controller.
Yeah.
All right. So because we've extended it, then we can just go into our public function action index. Return. Base.content. Right, so let's say this is hello. Okay, so if I go to the browser now, that has helped me eliminate site controller. Even though there is a way of eliminating site controller without creating another controller, right, there's a way we can actually do that, whereby if we want to say we have let's call it profile, right?
Okay.
Action profile, which is a public function, right? If you want to do this, whereby, you know, by default, if you want to access that, you go to profile, and this shows that the action is working. So let me just echo hello, right? Right. Also, in the recent updates of PHP or E, right? So when you echo in the controller, it's going to be giving error. So it is recommended you use return. All right.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's a way you can actually eliminate this site, and that is where your URL manager comes in. Right. So you go to URL manager, then you can tell URL manager the kind of URL you want. Yeah, so the kind of URL you want in the rules. So you say you want let's say profile only, and that profile will be gotten from site profile. This is going to work. At the same time, this is also going to work. All right, so you've eliminated the controller, so the user, they might not know what's happening in the background. But at the same time, the way you write a proper project structure that can be passed on to the next developer is, you know, creating an appropriate controller, creating a readable actions and functions and variable names. Then if need be, you can also make use of modules. But let's just go ahead with this index. So I think these two guys are now tackling each other. You know, we have LO capital letter here, LO small letter, and it is showing small letter because it's coming from controller, and that is because this guy came first before it enters the controller, right? Which is why it is accepting the one declared in the rules before now listening to the one called in the controllers. So immediately I remove this guy.
Okay.
So it's giving us error, and that's because we have it declared in the rules here. So let's remove it. So now we have our error, the proper error. Okay. So I mean the proper LO reader. So
yeah, I understand. Yes.
So this is I want to assume this is for create, and this is for this. That's for index, right? This is for, let's say we'll call it create. And I'm going to duplicate all of these guys. So let's say this is for
updates,
details, and this is for updates. All right. So this way, it is good that you have each of them separated. In that case, if you want to do create, right? If you want to do create, it's easier for you to do return. And enter your crate. So this way, it makes more sense that you have a controller called profile, and the action of that controller is create. For instance, maybe you are an admin user and you want to create new people, right? So in when you go to profile,
it's called that controller.
So when you go to profile, that means you want to call everybody. You want to see the list of everybody. And when you want to now create a new user, you just go to create
the
user
action.
Create action only. In that case, now they know that go to the domain name, enter the /profile, then create. And it's now easier for you to remember that, okay, if I want to update, I just need to change this to update, even though the object might require maybe parameters one or two, whatever, right? So that way it is easier. Now another thing we need to look at also is a scenario where we have like a multiple name that we want to declare. For instance, we want to have, let's say we want to create an action that we have two names joined together. So let's call it public function action, let's say verify user, right?
Okay.
So if you want to do verify user, this actually works. This actually works, but it is not the best method. Because verify user is actually two word, and remember what we are trying to do is to create a system that that both the URL and the project structure itself is easily readable. And what would have made more sense is for us to have not verify user but verify user. So when you have hyphen like this in your URL, it is more readable by even SEO, right? And the person that is trying to access the URL. And the good thing about having a neat proper URL is the fact that your user might be able to, you know, read it easily or memorize some of those simple URL. maybe the user usually access this particular URL very often, the user might memorize it easily and say, okay, just go to domain name and /profile and /verify user, and that is all they need to do. So for you to do that, all you need to make sure you do is that at the point where you want hyphen to take place, you have to start the next letter with capital letter. So that means if I want it to be verify user, I need to make sure U is starting with uppercase. That way, verify user is going to work. So in subsequent development, it is recommended that if you are going to use two words together, make sure they are separated with hyphen. All right, rather than being joined together or being separated with underscore. So that is that in the naming convention of actions. And sometimes if you really want to beautify your URL, right, in that case, let's say you want to take parameter of username, right, username. So this also works. Where you say username is equal, let's say, Afridemi, right? So let me return it.
Okay.
Right. So let's say username is Afridemi. So this is not easily readable compared to having it this way. This is better, right? But now for you to make this work, in that case you have to make sure you make use of your web rules. In that case, what you need to do is to first tell where you want the so let's say this is exactly what we are looking at for. In that case, we need to pick the controller and the action. Profile controller, action is verify user, right? And this will also be the same thing here, but because we are expecting, so it will also be the same thing, but because we are expecting parameter, in that case we need to make use of a parameter function in our rules. So what we need to call is, so for us to make use of this, for us to be able to include the parameter, we need to call the parameter name, which would be username in our case, right? And the question now is, what type of value do you want to accept? So the type of value you want to accept has a lot to say about the value you input between this backslash and plus. So if it is W, that means you want word or alphanumeric, right? But if you say D, that means you only want digit. For instance, let me put W, right? And W, right? And I hit enter. That means it is working. But immediately I change it to D, right? That means it is just digit. It only accept digit. That means if I change it from digit to maybe from word to digit, that is the only time to accept it. Anything outside number, it will not accept it. Okay, so you have to change this to W, and that is a way for us to, you know, beautify the, to accept parameter. So one of the other things I'll need to look at now is reusable code. All right, for instance, let's say part of the information I want to take, right, I want to take, maybe I have based on the user interface I'm designing, right, maybe based on the user interface I'm designing, and I need to maybe add a custom date, right? So first, before I do that, let me create profile, and I'm going to create a file called index.php. So let's say paste that in. So instead of returning content, I want to return the file here. So it's gonna be render. All right. So let's say we want to make use of readable code, and we need to display date, right? A readable date for ourselves. So let's say we have H1, and we need to display date. We have to specify how we want it. Let's say day, month, year, right? Let me make it a bit complex by adding, assuming I need to also include the time, the hour, the minutes and seconds, right? So let's say this is the information I have. All right.
Okay.
And in this case, it might be a bit simpler because it's just not too much line of a code. But the fact is, you need to make use of dates every now and then, and it will be a bit wrong for you to have this particular line of code written, let's say about 20 different places in your application, and maybe there's need for you to customize, maybe change the format of this date. Or in some cases, you might be required to provide, maybe a date that is stored in your database. You might be required to provide the date, right? That means you need to retrieve the information from database and pass it through this place. So it would be wrong for you to have this in different files scattered. And when the time comes for you to make changes, maybe you want to make changes from this format to maybe much simpler formats. Right.
Yeah, I have to go each of them one by one.
Instead of going to each of them, that is when component comes in. And in some cases, we have people that usually create component in mode, right? For you to be able to create a component easily, first of all, create a folder called components. Folder.
Okay.
We'll call it components. Alright. So inside the components, inside the component folder is where we'll now create the date time. Alright. So the first thing we need to do is, let's say we want to create a date format component. So the name you call it is left to you, right? So I'm going to call it date time or date formatter or format. Note that whatever it is you want to use this component for, what you store in component does not have limits. It could be anything, it could varies from anything, right? So it's just left for you to, it's left for you to determine what you want to do with it. All right. And so in this component, what we need to do is we need to extend widgets. So we need to extend widgets.
Yeah, with you.
All right. So for our widgets, so we can just do.
This is widgets.
Public function, yes. Run as an example, right? So what run does is it allows you to return, let's say, hello, right? It's easier for you to easily return it. So I'm going to create another line and call my widget date format.
Public function.
Yeah. Right, and that is all I need to do. If I go back there, it says class the format not found. Alright, I need to use namespace. Right, proper namespace. So the namespace is gonna be namespace. It will be app component. Alright. let me go back to the index. Okay, dates format. All right, so we are returning hello. So if you want to if you want to now pass in, let's say we want to render this date, right? This is what we want to return. Let's say this is what we want to return. Then we can easily return date and we'll have our date displayed. All right, but in most cases we expect that we are going to have a custom input, meaning we expect the user to give us a date. In that case, we need to declare the dates that will come in. Yes. All right. That means you need to declare the data that is coming in. And that will be for us to do public. Then the name of our variable. And for us to be able to access it in the body, that means you need to make use of this dot date. I mean, for date. So having this, it's easier. It will be, we need to pass in the data that we want to make use of, and that would be for us to pass in the date and the value of the date. So I'm just going to pass in the time, right? But in your case, it might be that you want to pass in the, it might be that you want to pass in maybe the date from your database, or your time from your database. And this is how you can make use of reusable code.
Yeah.
So that means anywhere you want to call, anywhere you want to call you are making use of dates, right? And there's need for you to make change to that date. So yeah, instead of you going to each line of code, you've written your date, you just come here, modify it, and the result is, you get the result. So it might be simple, or this might not be really, really relevant in terms of this code, but there are some cases whereby you need to write about 20 lines of code, 50 lines of code, just to probably give you the exact result you want. Maybe you want to filter, or you want to modify, or whatever it is you want to do, right? So it makes sense that you create a component that you can use across all parts of application. So doing this is going to save you in... So doing this, that means you'll be practicing something we call DRY, which means don't repeat yourself, right? So this is how you create multiple components.
Yourself.
Yeah. Wow. So this is how you create components, and the components you are creating allow you to easily use the code all over and all over and all over again without, repeating so many code that you could have just written once. And so the next thing is, that means, so now let's say we want to now create another segment of the application. Maybe you are creating like e-commerce, right? Maybe you are creating e-commerce, and there's need for you to have, so let's say we are looking at component of e-commerce as an example, right?
Yeah.
For e-commerce, we are going to have authentication, right? And that authentication includes login, sign up, and etc. Right? Those basic things. So those ones can actually reside in sites. But where you want to build user profile, right? The profile needs to have its own controller separately, and that means this authentication should be in sites. All right. So this guy needs to be in a separate controller. Then inside the profile, you cannot have. So inside this control, inside profile controller, you cannot have maybe view profile, whatever it is you want to call it, right? Update profile.
Yeah.
Change email. Change password. Depending on how complex you want your profile to be, right? In some cases whereby change password, delete account, notification preferences, right? They need to stay separately. In such case, you might need to have a controller called settings, right? So under settings, you might say change email, right? Under settings, you might say change
password.
password. Under this settings, I say delete account. That is if need be. Delete account. Under this page, you might have preferences or email preferences or whatever preferences, maybe general preferences, right? So in this case, your code become neater. You know, if you want to do anything regarding profile, you go to profile, right? In case you want to do anything regarding the system setting, you go to setting.
Wow, I see.
Now, the next thing you want to do, maybe you might want to have maybe product, right? So under products, you might maybe your index, right, might be for product or product listing. And maybe you might want to have product details. That means you want to see details of our products. Maybe you want to have add to cart. So this add to cart might not be a page that renders a view. It might just be a page that an action you call when you submit a form and automatically go back to where you are coming from. So that means instead of putting all those action of check this table, check that table, match this data together, or whatever action or flow you want to call, right? You might not want to put all of them into the same page where you are calling. For instance, let's say on product listing page, and there's a button on all the product that says add to cart, right? You might not want to put the action inside your index. You might not want to put your action here and say if you start checking your if posts and etc. Right? Posts. Right. You might not want to start doing your check database, check DB. Validate, store there, and maybe you can now say update cards, right? You might not want to have this action in this particular index because there might be so many other action that there might be so many other instruction you need to call, probably in terms of filtering of the index page and others. So in that case, you might want to create a function. You want to create a function that all it does is let's say update cart, so let's call it update cart, right? So in this case, you can check, and if it is successful, you can just return that it should go back to the previous URL, right? You can tell it to go back to the previous URL. That means nobody is ever going to see anything on this page, right? Ordinarily, the code they need to run get executed. Automatically, it takes them back to where they're coming from. So it's going to be... So if they want to go back to where they are coming from, it's gonna be a referral. So this just automatically takes it. So let's say I'm moving from index to this page. Automatically, immediately finish executing this code and gets done, it goes back to index page. So that is what you might want to do in such case, right? So that brings me to back to the list, right? So that means you might have so many actions under the product. You might have action one, action two, action as an example, right? Your action is unlimited. In that case, your code will even be able to breathe, right? You know that everything about the product goes into the product controller. Everything about your profile goes into profile. And even if there's need for you to check out, also you can now create cart controller separate. Right? You can now have maybe undercut, we can have a list cuts, right? All the items or product has been cutted. Maybe you want to list them.
List cut items.
Yeah, maybe you want to maybe hard cut. Maybe say you want to remove from cart, maybe an item that is already in cart, you want to remove it.
Update.
You might want to remove, or you want to update. Maybe you want to add item you selected, instead of, maybe you will need two of it, right? So you can call the cut function, maybe update function or increment, whatever you call the action name, right?
Yes.
And whatever it is you want to do, action two, action three, etc. And that is how you will eventually need to structure your code. And with this, even yourself, if something is wrong in the application, you know the controller to go to. And that does not involve you spending hours looking for the line of code you are where you wrote that function, right? And so that is it about project structuring per se. But in some cases where you have a very robust application, maybe you have different type of users and you don't want all of them to all be together. For instance, let's say on e-commerce, you have the user, meaning a regular person that goes to the platform, have an account, be able to buy, be able to have to cart, be able to remove from cart, be able to change their email preferences and etc. All the stuff we listed there. And there's another guy that is a seller also that that has so many things together. So instead of you having so many countless controllers that contains all of them together, right? Maybe eventually the user alone is having about maybe 15 controllers or 10 controllers. So instead of having additional 10 or 15 controllers on the seller, right? What you might want to do is create modules for each of them. Meaning you might want to leave the user here and only create module for the seller. So I'm going to create the seller module seller, right? And the purpose of that module is, let's say seller also has all of the profile settings, controller, etc. Yeah. So what the URL eventually will look like will be something like, right, seller, because seller will know that, oh, I'm under the seller. Then you cannot have your action. Or first, let me start. It's going to be module controller action and if need be parameter. You get what I'm saying? So your module can be seller, while your action be let's say profile as an example, right? Because seller was definitely have a profile. Then the next thing will be maybe it's gonna be update, right? Maybe you're updating profile. Then maybe since you are a single user, right? You're not managing other people, so you might not need to pass parameter. But let's say you're trying to update a product, right? So we have product controller, and we have detail or something, product detail. Then you cannot have the ID of that product. All right, so this gives you module, controller, action, and parameter that is passed into the module. So the next thing I want to do is, the question now is, how do we generate that? So for us to generate it, just let's go to input key, right? So now this is giving us forbidden, and that this is happening because I'm actually making use of Docker, and this is specifically happening also because I'm not making use of the basic default IP, meaning meaning Docker itself is generating IP outside the local host or the basic local host that the system or the YE is basically designed to accept by default. So for us to be able to do that, we need to determine allow IPs, right? So if we go back, it will still not give us. But in that case, you might need to either allow all of them. But if you don't want to, if you don't want to expose it to all of them, right? Then you might want to also include your local system IP address. So once you're able to get your local system IP, you just include it. But for this case, let's just use asterisk. That means you want to accept all kind of IP, but it is not safe to use. So it's, I'm not generating model, right? So for model, you just need to make use of you can generate model into model table, and generate model. Don't repeat. Don't create multiple model. Don't create multiple model for a single table. You can extend your. You can extend a single model. For instance, let's say you create a model, and that's a model. Depending on different pages that the user is, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe in page one, as an example, maybe in page one of the user, right? Let's say we have product, and in add product page, add product action, right? You might want to have the name, let's say product title, price, discount, add information about the product, right? And because all of these guys are required, so that means the user cannot submit it without providing all this information. But in case there you find yourself in a way whereby all of these feeds are empty, or for in some cases one of these feeds might be empty, that is required, and you only want to update maybe price only, right? Mm-hmm. And if you want to update price, it might not allow you to update price, because it will tell you so if you check the error, it will tell you, see that other feeds are required. That's where you'll be getting error like discount cannot be empty, price cannot be empty, right?
Yeah.
But in case you only want to make sure that the user provide price only, but every other thing is not necessary, in that case you might make use of scenario, right? So just make use of scenario. Okay, scenario that saves you the stress of so our scenario work is this. So for this, so that's another video entirely, right? So if you want to talk about scenario, I think I might just create a different video for that.
Okay,
but for this,
I think I saw it in the code base of the textbox.
All right. Awesome. So, but in this case, don't generate multiple model to a single table. Okay. So to round up quickly, so let's generate module, right? And what we're going to do is, depending on the app we're using, module, app modules, then it's gonna be the name of the module, right? And module ID.
It's a mistake with SELTA.
Okay. So this will be the name of the module, then the module configuration, right? So immediately you click on module ID, automatically generate seller to you. This is the name of the module. So if I click on preview, these are the information it gives me. And if I click on generate, automatically it gives me this information also. That means I need to go into web config, right? To access module, you need to add this to your application configuration. That means I need to go into web config. First, the module has been generated for us, right?
Yeah.
So, and we cannot access seller yet until we cannot access seller until we add it to config. So for us to be able to do that, we'll need to copy that line of code that was generated for us, and paste. Let's say I want to paste in before the components, right? But note that in case you are creating another module, let's say I call it buyer, right? And so automatically I change this to buyer as well, right? So let's say I want to change this module and I generate a new module. So it's still going to give me the same code. That does not mean I need to copy the whole line of code. Instead, I just need to copy.
Just to add the buyer, the seller.
Yes. Buyer. Yes. So I just need to add the buyer to it, and both of them will work. So in this case, if I go back to my previous page and I hit enter, seller starts working. So now the good thing about this, about module, is the fact that module allow you to create a new set of controllers. Right, you can create as much controller as you want here, and it will not affect the ones you have here. In that case, you know that everything about the seller is in seller module, from profile, whatever it is you want to think about creating about seller, just create them here, and you know the controllers and the views are here. In case you want to generate separate model for separate component, you can also create a module for seller, a models for seller. I mean, you create a folder for models, then generate the files. But that is not advisable, right? Make sure your application generally make use of one model, then you cannot extend or, you know, improve on it.
Okay, so that means there's no need for one to add the model directory inside that seller module anymore.
No, you can call any module. Okay. You can call any model you need from here. So let's say we have this login or contact form model, where I can call contact form model and still make use of it. Automatically, it get added to your controller. All right.
Okay.
Yeah. So that is basically it, and that's where your code will be extremely fresh, good, and understandable. You get. And one other thing you need to make sure you do is try as much as possible to comment on your code. So that if possible, another developer is likely to join you or take over, right? So the person can easily understand, and make sure you make use of a readable variable name. So that means if you are trying to get maybe information of a product, let's say you are trying to get product details, don't say PD, it's equal the product details, right? Don't do that. So instead, try as much as possible to use, maybe you call it products details, then you can pass your variable to it, your data to it, or your object to it, and you're good to go. So that's basically it. Do you have any question?
Yeah, I think I have one or two.
All right.
If you go to the sites controller,
okay.
I saw something. You wrote something like render content. Like the render content there, what is it? I believe the render content means because you're not calling a file.
Yes.
That's why you're using render content.
So I use render content because I want to render whatever string or whatever
string
I want to pass into it without calling a file. At the same time, I want to maintain the layout. So the purpose of using render content, the benefit of using render content is the fact that when you use render content, you still see the layout. If you have footer also, you see footer. Just that this is just a pure string that you are inputting from controller.
Okay.
By the time you do return only without using render content, right, all of these guys will not be there. You only see this guy.
True.
Yeah. All right. Another question.
Okay. Yeah, the second one. The component.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you want to create another component,
okay.
Definitely that means what that component is trying to say, like how you explain it, that for every component that you need to make, you have to create another file in the component that.
So the purpose of components is not for this kind of one line now of code, all right? It is meant for it can actually work for date as well, in as much as you know that this particular date format has to go across all parts of the application, and I do not want to repeat this format anywhere else. So you can write this and use it everywhere you go. And in case it requires parameter, I mean value, you need to pass in value, then you can easily just declare it, and wherever it is being used, you will have to pass in the data and it will be good to go. So to answer your question, yes, when you are creating components, you have to create them afresh. You have to create different names. For instance, I have a project I've worked on, right, whereby I have over 50 components, and that is because each of those components are unique. I have about 4 different modules on the application also, that they are all working separately, but there are certain components that needs to cross across all of them, right? Maybe for instance, maybe the profile, the image that is showing, the profile image at the top, let's say you have a profile menu, or let's say this you are authenticated and you have image that is showing your profile somewhere at the top here, right? That you might actually pass that into a component, and you don't have to write the same HTML, CSS, or whatever line of code you have there. You don't have to repeat them all over again across 4 different users. You can just write it in a component and render it. And remember, component is not just about passing string. It can also contain HTML, right? Meaning, if I want certain set of HTML in addition to PHP, maybe PHP, to work together, right? I could also make use of, you know, HTML in there. I just need to make sure I use HTML code, right? HTML. So let's say you want to pass in some additional data, right? You want to use HTML helper, you can use HTML helper. If you want to write your plain HTML, right, so you can also do that. Just that you might need to do your proper concatenation, all right? H2. So if you want to render that, I'll just knock it off this H1.
So one doesn't need to write that again.
Yes. And sorry, it's not HTML code. It's supposed to be decode.
Okay, decode.
Yeah. So HTML decode. So the purpose of that is it helps you also filter through unnecessary malicious string that maybe a user might want to pass in. So it depends on whatever, right? Just make sure you properly decode it, and you're good to go. So your component doesn't have to be one liner, but in case you are trying to do maybe different type of inheritable functions, right?
Yeah.
You can also create a component. In this case, we are extending widgets, right? You can also create a component. Yes. Let's call it statistics, right? Maybe you are trying to, your application, you have to return statistics to users, right? Okay. So you might want to extend model, right? So you can start writing your function, let's say public function, let's say get stats or something, right? So maybe you want to create another one called calculate right? So maybe you want to have calculated that I have a variable passed in, and you want to return the data here. Maybe you want to say calculated or something. All right, so calculate. So you can just pass your, that is if you're passing variable, you just need to make sure you pass your variable in here and you are good to go. So in this case, instead of writing maybe about 2000 lines of code or 100 lines of code as an example, right, you might just break them into chunks and just make them narrow to each other, meaning the line of code that ought to have been, that you probably would have made this place look a bit ugly, can just pass into another function and just pass the result into a variable and make use of the results.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's it. So you can make use of model, you can make use of widgets. So you are not restricted to just using widgets only. Alright?
Okay.
Just that eventually when you want to call this model, right? So let's say I want to call model. Return as an example, right? Let's say return name is Afridemi. Let's say you want to return this guy, so in the and you want to make his obvious in the controller, right? So you might just want to say first, for you to call that, you need to make use of statistics, right?
Okay.
So it is not advisable. I think it's going to throw an error if you do get. So it's first you need to make sure you call the class and declare it. So let's call it get, and call it statistics, new statistics, right? So
okay,
doing that, you can now say get, what's the name, get stats, right? And you can pass it into variable or use it whatever. In that case, that means whatever results you get from here,
yeah,
right, can be used in the body. All right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. So that's it. Any other question?
Yeah. So, lastly, I think, how do one manage the database using Docker?
So there are other Docker scripts you might need to write if you want to create Docker to create your database. There are so many. First, you need to go to Docker website, right? You need to access their hub before you can now see all of the possible products that are available, or possible packages that are available. For instance, if your live server is making use, so one of the benefits of making use of Docker is the fact that it sometimes enables you and keeps you on the same page as on the same page of maybe the live server. For instance, maybe multiple people are working on the project, so it saves you the stress of person A is working on using PHP 5.4, person B is using PHP 7.0, and maybe the line of code you're writing, some might return error, the other person might not see error. So to avoid those incompatibility issue, that's the purpose of Docker, because immediately I share my config with you, the application will be running on your system using the same configuration. All right. And maybe your live server, your system, you're making use of, maybe, I don't know, whatever operating system you're using. On your live server, you are making use of Ubuntu, right? Or Linux in general. So because you are making use of Docker, you can tell the application to also run in the background of maybe Linux.
Okay.
You get what I'm saying? So you can tell it to run whatever it is you want. So for instance, let's say we are looking for PHP, right? If you want to install PHP, instead of you making use of the likes of XAMPP to install PHP for you, right here you can just set up PHP, right? That is if you want to manually configure all of these guys. But he has actually saved you all the stress by giving you Docker Compose. So that is all you just need to do. All right.
Okay.
So the database, like the
main database, like
all right.
So let me say you migrate, for instance, now.
Okay.
You know, you create the user and the migrate.
So, as I was saying, exam. I get you. So as I was saying, in case you want to install MySQL, you might have to install MySQL into your Docker and configure it. But if you do that, that means the MySQL you configured inside this Docker Compose will only be relevant to the container, to this container. Meaning, outside this project, maybe you create another project and call it a different name, you will not be able to access this database you have here. That means you are going to get a fresh database with no table or no database installed.
All right.
Except you now manually, you know, create a network by connecting to a different container, which to me, I don't think it is good. But if you are kind of a freelancer, you have so many projects you're working on, you can actually make use of that, whereby you create a SQL server for a different project. But what I do is I have a central, you know, on my system, I make use of Mac. I have a central SQL. Server, right, that access, and so that's all I need to do in my application. And if I want to connect to any database, instead of me connecting, remember I'm running on Docker, right? So instead of me to make use of localhost is not going to work, because localhost, it does not recognize any let me act as if I want to log in also. Okay, so because it's in basic, we just have we've not been connected to the database, right? But let's say we are trying to connect to GI, right? And remember, GI content, especially the model, is coming from database, so it's saying no such file or directory. So now, that is because it is not even connecting to your database. So if you want it to connect to your database, so all you need to do is to make sure you're getting the right connection string. But for XAMPP, this is going to work. But if you want to make use of Docker, all you need to do is make use of host.docker.internal, right? Your message is going to change there to now start telling you root user, password, and etc. But if I miss anything here, right, it's going to tell me that the service name is not known.
Okay.
So that is basically how you connect to external database from container.
Okay.
Yes. Any other question?
So then you now create the database manually.
Yes. So in that case, you cannot create the database in your SQL server, right?
Okay.
And in case you want to be seeing all your database all together in a place, maybe your project 1 database, your project 2 database, at least you know that you have everything together. Because in some cases, you might even want to, you know, when we want to run the application, right?
Yeah.
If you want to run the application, you do Composer up. Now, if you do Composer down, it automatically deletes all of your container in Docker. And that includes whatever database you might have created if you set up your database in the container you earlier created. You lose your database, you lose everything. In that case, you might have to start thinking all over again, which is some of the benefits of using migration, right? Migration allow you to store the query. So in case you lose database, you just need to run SQL migrate and e-migrate reader, and automatically all your tables are back. But that's a separate discussion.